different biological function, on majority of you all know maybe the sialic acid, role of sialic acid in viral infection, in flu, the entry, so it acts as the entry for flu and rotavirus. Heparin, you may all heard about it, it used as an anticoagulant agent for more than 100 years. And it also indicate the change in the glycan pattern in the cell surface indicate tumor metathesis and also the different deadly disease and the chronic disease like diabetes, Alzheimer's and cardiovascular disease. So this is some structural input before I going inside of my research work. This is N-glycan. This is a picture, you can left hand side, you can see the pictorial representation of the N-glycan, where is the yellow color is galactose, green color is mannose, and the blue color is glucagon, and this red color is fructose, and this is sialic acid. And whereas glycosamine glycan, they are subdivided in four parts, majorly heparin, keratin sulfate, DS, and hyaluronic acid. All these are, you see that they are negatively charged. You may have known this hyaluronic acid if you buy a cosmetic products from market or eye drop, if you see the composition, you can find this particular entity there. So as I discussed in the first slide, the glycan plays several role, biological role. One of the major role is a viral entry. In the surface of the cell, we have this kind of glycan, this is heparin sulfate or sialic acid. And when viral particle approach to the host cell is initially attached to the surface which is recognized by the epitope present in the surface. And the linkage between this sugar is very important for the avian flu. The alpha-2-3 sialic acid is recognized by the flu, whereas in human flu the linkage is different, so alpha-2-6. So how this entire mechanism work, you can read in details. Now a lot of paper is available because it's the COVID time. But generally it is two major pathway, which is direct fusion. So it comes through, the viral particle comes to the cell surface and directly attaches to the surface, which is called fusion, or endocytosis, in which the glycan help to recognize the first glycan and then followed by the endocytosis. Influenza use this kind of sialic acid receptor through the association of the hemagglutinin antigen, which lead to entry of the cell. And at this is time of the, we all know this is in pandemic time due to the COVID-19. And various paper has been published in last 1.5 months, and they're showing the showcase of what kind of glycan pattern is available in the spike or S protein. So the recent article came, I think 2 weeks back, where they show that in the S protein is divided in S1 and S2. And all these, the units, subunit are all highly glycosylated. You can see here all this portable glycan, probable glycan structure represented here. In majority case, they are high monostructure. You can see right-hand side, you can see there is no glucagon, no fructose or sialic acid. Or some of the cases is it's O-glycan as here. And some is very rare case, they are non-G, that is non-glycosylated protein. Right-hand side, I show here how the N-glycan in incubated or N-glycan is structurally oriented in the spike protein. As well as also last week, last week publication from Linhart group show that heparin sulfate, that is negatively charged glycan, which also helped to entry of COVID-19. Now the question is it good or bad? Because you may think that entry of virus is not good for our study, but yeah, this is a platform by which we can develop a therapeutic vaccine or therapeutic glycotherapeutics for COVID. So during my postdoc, I was interested in synthesis and development, methodology development for heparin and heparin sulfate. And heparin and heparin sulfate has been used as a anticoagulant for more than 100 years now. And as I can, so the right-hand side, left-hand side, you can see there's two major structures. Called one is pondaponics, this is pentasaccharide heparin sulfate, and is hydroponics, which is also a modified hornopyrinix has been commercialized back in 2002. This has been used for deep vein thrombosis, in which in the deep vein in the leg has clotting of the blood, and this can be cleared by this kind of blood thinner. And pulmonary embolism, if you read recent article, I think day before yesterday in NBC and major of this US newspaper indicate that this is the one of the major reason for the COVID death, where we can get pulmonary embolism, and they are planning to use this kind of blood thinner to make it not to make, to clear this blood clotting. But this is the present scenario of the heparin sulfate. There is several other biological role. I'm not going to discuss them today all. But in future, we can think the research article coming throughout the years, heparin is a cancer biomarker. And recent article indicate that in the metastasis stage of the cancer, the high sulfated glycan present. So it can help as a cancer biomarker, or in Alzheimer. A recent article also in 2017 showed that the sulfate of the heparin pentasaccharide interact with the toxic tau oligomer, which is responsible for neural death of the neural cells in Alzheimer. So now coming to the production, so we understand the heparin has a immense role, starting from anticoagulant to several biological role and future prospect. But the major question remains, how you produce the heparin in large quantity. You can see here right hand side, it is generally produced in China from the peak intense time by extracting heparin. And the major difficulties in extraction of this low molecular heparin is the contamination. So there is no real method by which we can control the quality of commercial heparin and remove the contamination. And in 2008, due to this contamination, 100 patients passed away in United States. So there is a need or requirement to find an alternative solution. And second aspect is that as it is extracted from pig intestine, it is very difficult to use some of the religious people, because a pig is not allowed in some of the major religious people across the world. So the possible solution that marine organism as a source of heparin, where the risks of the contamination of pathogen is very, very less. And other solution is chemical and chemoenzymatic synthesis, by which we can synthesize majority of this low molecular as well as particular fragmented of the heparin without any contamination. Now coming to synthetic challenge in heparin, because if you see the structure here, you can find the majority of the sugar entity here, either iodose or glucosamine, they're very low reactive. And all this linkage, you can see here the in fondapyrinix case, this is alpha, beta, alpha, alpha, alpha. So stereoselective alpha glycosylation, regioselective installation of the sulfate and any sulfate. And so the problem is that once you try to optimize this kind of synthesis of this kind of molecule, you would end up with the long synthetic steps with multiple purification. And that that's also makes low yield, efficiency, and high price. So now how to tackle the synthetic problems or challenges? There's two paths. One is automated synthesis or programmable synthesis, which I'm going to discuss largely. And then there's another path, which is enzymatic synthesis. Coming to the part programmable one-pot synthesis, which I was involved in Professor Wang lab. The fundamental concept was that can we develop a computer program by which we can use to simplify the synthetic protocol for oligosaccharide. However, this has not been started means in one shot. There's a history. The effect of the protein groups on the rate of the hydrolysis of the glycosyl chloride was developed by Hans Poisson back in 1974, and followed by Faisal Reed and co-workers developed armed and disarmed concept in back in 90s. But both of these concepts indicate that the role of the protein group qualitatively. So let's consider you have acetyl as benzyl or benzoate, Now you all know that some of them are electron withdrawing and some of them electron donating. So there will be the change of the reactivity of the molecule if you have presence of this kind of protecting group. But how to quantify it? So Stephen Lay and co-worker back in Cambridge, they started to quantify it. And one of these paper, he stated that in order to achieve the synthesis of the complex oligosaccharide, the reactivity of the donor must be quantified. However, there is no general idea how to quantify this kind of the reactivity of the glycosyl donor. And then in 1998, Professor Wang and co-worker developed a concept called relative reactivity value, or RRV, in based of 1H NMR, HPLC, and computer program. So there's two computer program now available. One is Optima software, which was developed in 1999, and AutoCHO software, which was developed in 2018. The concept is that when you have a complex oligosaccharide structure, you input the oligosaccharide structure in the computer, and then computer program give you optimization route or output based on the reactivity of the sugar donor. And then you have to synthesize those molecule in the lab, couple them in sequence to get protected oligosaccharide, deprotect it to get the desired oligosaccharide. And this works in such a fashion, you can see in the right-hand side, the most reactive, then less reactive, least reactive, and so on. And it's something like stop codon. So you can stop the synthesis of this oligosaccharide if your least reactive, the number three, is not a donor. So if you don't have acetyl group in X, then it will not reactive, not considered to be a reactive. So you can put like OME or other functional group apart from acetyl, so there will be the stop. So you can monitor based on your design and what kind of glycan pattern you want to synthesize. Here is a video I'm going to link. You can, if you want, you can later on, I can send the video so you can find out how exactly we developed this one and how we can use it in a real time. So now what is the difference between these two software? In optimal software, so we need to measure the building block, reactivity of the building block in the lab, and then input the software. And in AutoCHO software, we increase the building block from 50 to 150. And now we can theoretically predict the RRV value. It is more than 50,000 building block incorporated in the AutoCHO software. And you can see in the right-hand side that the predicted and observed reactivity in majority cases is very, very close. So that means the AutoCHO software works well as far as the experimental RRV is concerned. Now, AutoCHO software works some of the based on some computer parameters, is used graphical user interface and Java runtime environment. And we, as I mentioned before, we use more synthetic building block. And just in library has been increased from 50 to 150. And it's the first time we use fragment coupling, one-pot synthesis. And we use chemical shift of the particular sugar entity. And then we took that value and put RRP predictor by SVM regression model. We have this another software, Glycan Builder. So what Glycan Builder will help to draw this sugar structure, sugar stripe, anomeric configuration, and define the fragment to be used. So let's consider this GlobOH, which is the antigen present in the cancer cell. So you want to synthesize this particular AutoCHO glycan. So you have to input the structure in the software, and then software will search for you and give you the outcome. So consider the B, where you, the computer software show that you need to take this three one monosaccharide, one disaccharide, one trisaccharide, and then couple them to get this this GlobOH or the fragment coupling. So they also, computer also showed that trisaccharide can be fragmented to monosaccharide and how you can synthesize them. It also can predict the yield. However, you know that sometimes it will be difficult to tally the predicted yield with the yield you are getting in the lab, in the laboratory experiment. So my interest, as I told before, that my interest was synthesis of heparin pentasaccharide. So I input the structure into AutoCHO software, and AutoCHO software give outcome. that this pentasaccharide can be synthesizing using compound 1A, 2B, and 3, or 1A, 2A, and 3. And you see, it's based on the reactivity decrement of the reactivity. So one reactivity of 1 is 132, whereas 2B is 38.2, 2A is 18.2. And as the compound 3 don't have any acetylyl group, the reactivity is 0. So once we get this initial information, we synthesize those molecules in the laboratory and then couple in sequence to get this pentasaccharide, protected pentasaccharide. And then we do deprotection and chemical sulfation to get our desired heparin pentasaccharide. Now question is how you measure this RRB of thioglycoside donor. For doing this, let's consider that you have compound RX and you want to measure the reactivity of this compound. So you dissolve in DCM and inject in HPLC and record its absorbance at time is equal to 0. And you need to take a reference compound. In the RRB of this reference compound is already in the library. So again, you dissolve them in DCM, dissolve in DCM and inject to HPLC and measure the A reference value at time is equal to 0. Now, next is to mix those two compounds in 1:1 ratio and add excess methanol and put in glycoside recondition for 30 minutes and room temperature to make sure that maximum of this donor react with the methanol and quench filter workup and again inject in HPLC to find out the absorption value after time T. And from this equation, as all these parameters are known, you can find out the value of the Kx, which is the RRB of your desired compound. So the computer give outcome that this one pot synthesis of this heparin pentasaccharide has been performed in one in the decrement of the reactivity and has to be a alpha selective glycosylation. The alpha selectivity has been governed by presence of the TBDPS group or O acetyl group at the C6 position. So you see the red color indicates the formation of only alpha linkage. There is no alpha beta mixture. However, we did not publish this article as a methodology, and recently we found that in Gao and co-workers, they reported the similar methodology for the alpha selective glycosylation by blocking the beta phase from the C6 protecting group. So these are the following glycosyl donor and acceptor. Here is some glycosyl glucose donor. In the down, you can see two glucose donor, two gluconic donor with azide, and the iodose donor, which were synthesized in the laboratory. And then once we synthesize those molecule in lab chemically, we attempted for one pot synthesis as guided by computer. So we took compound 1, 2A, and either 3A, 3B, 3C, 3D to get pentasaccharide, or compound 1A, 2B, 3A, 3B, 3C, 3D, any of them. And we found in majority cases, the yield is like 48 to 54%, which is good in the one pot synthesis. But now question is that, now which route should we prefer? 1, 2A, 3A, or 1, 2B, 3B? Because computer informed us that both route is feasible. And true, the both route is feasible and you get a good amount of yield. However, we found that in the heparin pentasaccharide, we need to oxidize this this R group for 2B. So we need to remove the OPMP group. So that has been done by DDQ and followed by oxidation by BIB tempo and then esterification. So the yields drop down. You can see here 35F, the yields drop down to 42%. So it's better to introduce ester at the beginning. In that case, the yield is 54%, which is 35A. Now, once we got this pentasaccharide as guided by AutoCHO software, next task was how to install O sulfate at 6 position. For doing this, we remove first TBDPS group here using HA-pyridine to get this hydroxy derivative 36A or 36B, and then protect this OH group as OBN. Now, you can see here we have a lot of ester functions, right? CO2ME, OBZ, or OAC. So we cannot use any the known protocol like sodium hydride and benzyl bromide because that will hydrolyze all. So we use silver oxide mediated benzylation at C6 position and followed by hydrolysis or saponification reaction of the all ester functionality using lithium hydroxide to generate compound 38. And we took this crude compound and treated with sulfur trioxide diethylamine and to get compound 38, and followed by removal of the benzyl group using hydrogen palladium charcoal to make it OH, and also azide reduced to NH2, and then protection of the NH2 as sulfate to get this heparin pentasaccharide. And now you can see you have two sulfate group, right? So we can regioselectively install sulfate and in C and E, but we can keep hydroxy open at fragment A. Similarly, we can install one sulfate at C, keeping the other two hydroxy. Animation doesn't work here. So E and A is been OH, and you can make C part as sulfate. Next, we focused our attention for the synthesis of commercial duct fondoprenix. And as I informed before, that it is used for deep vein thrombosis and was marketized by Glaxo back in 2002. And it is more potent and more safe than low molecular heparin sulfate, which has been generally imported from China. And doses is general 5 mg to 10 mg by intravenous. All thing is very good compared to low molecular heparin sulfate. That the major concern is the price. So in United States, the price is almost $4,000 for 30 syringe, which contain 10 mg syringe. And so now the question is how to improve the synthetic efficiency to get access of this kind of heparin pentasaccharide to reduce the cost. And people has been trying to make a scalable synthesis from last 10 years. And I'm showing now few of them. You see majority of the synthetic step is very long, right? 36, 64, 45, and overall yield is very low. So the drawback is that majority case is the non-stereoselective glycosylation. As you can see in the last project, I have shown you how we can govern the stereoselective glycosylation. So non-stereoselective glycosylation and long synthesis make it very difficult to access. So we approach this problem using our programmable one-pot synthesis using alpha-selective glycosylation. We improve the yield from 3.5%, and we completed the synthesis in 24 step, longest linear route. So this is in now review currently. So we use the similar protocol, and I'm not going to show exactly what kind of protein group we use here. But again, you see the computer guided protocol make it very easy to synthesize this pentasaccharide, and we do deep protection and chemical sulfation to get this compound fondoprenix. And this is now possible to synthesize in scalable. I think we can able to synthesize almost 300 to 500 mg, and we can make it scalable. I think somebody will do in Dr. Wong lab later on. And next, we focused our attention to another commercial drug, which is hydroprenix. It is fully O-methylated. If you see the structural difference between fonda and hydra, that we don't have any N-sulfate here, right? So red color is all O-sulfate. And we don't have hydroxy group, that we have a methoxy group. And this has been introduced by Sanofi back in 2008. And then Sanofi discontinued this hydroprenix due to intracranial bleeding side effects. And again, 2011, Sanofi introduced a second generation drug of hydroprenix in which a biotin conjugation is present at the glucose residue at the far end side. And there is only 5 synthetic reports from 1994 from 2017, and the majority of the reports is long and non-stereoselective glycosylation and very low yield. So we approach this problem by synthesizing modular one-pot synthesis and alpha-selective glycosylation by TBDPS and acetyl group, as I have shown before also. And we used naturally available D-cellobios for making glucose-glucose disaccharide. You can see here this number 2 ring and 3rd ring, this glucose-glucose disaccharide. And the yield is now 6.8% in 22 steps. This is the previous reported synthesis report. And if you see the majority of the cases, alpha-beta mixture, you see here, the key step in the top, 7:1, so no selectivity. In tetradin publication, there's 4 different compounds. So once you get this kind of mixture, it's very difficult to get yield and to finish this total synthesis in shortest synthetic route. Here also in 2013 data had done, you can find 1:1 ratio, so no selectivity. So for doing that, we used a glycosyl phosphate, which has been synthesized from tetrahydroxyacetolide and protect the 6% by TBDPS and rest of the hydroxyglutide O-methyl, and then installed phosphate from acetolide using known protocol. And we also took D-cellulobase for this disaccharide synthesis, which is commercially available. And in three steps, known protocol, you can synthesize compound six and protect all this hydroxyl group, as you can see here, acetyl, install acetolide, and remove the acetyl group, followed by the introduction of TBDPS group at 6-6 position, and then benzylation, and give compound 10, which is dibenzyl, and remove this benzylated ring using acidic condition to get dihydroxy compound, oxidation using BIAB, and then esterification, give this ester, compound 12, and remove the TBDPS group, and install acetyl group in situ to get compound 13. And for another disaccharide 22, we start with diacetone glucose, which is commercially available, and we end up with the iodose. So this is not a glucose, right? This is iodose. This conformation is different. We get alpha beta mixture of the acetyl group, and then install acetolyl group, which also alpha beta mixture. Interesting part is that you can see here OAC is NGP, right? So it has NGP, but NGP doesn't work here, right? And then we remove the acetyl group, protect benzylidine, to get this alpha and beta, separation of alpha and beta. We took only alpha, install OBZ at C2 position, and coupled with 18 and 19. 19 was synthesized from alpha methyl glucoside in known procedure, and then get compound 20. Now remove the benzyl group to make OME, and then hydrolysis of the benzylidine ring, followed by oxidation by BIAB and esterification, give this compound 22 in good yield. Once we got these three compounds, we attempt modular 1-4 synthesis. So this all module has been made, 5, 13, and 22. Now we have one phosphate as a living group, one acetolyl is a living group. So we activate the phosphate using TMS triplet initially to get this disaccharide. And when this disaccharide generated in situ, we activate the acetolyl using addition of NIS and excess amount of 22, get this compound 23, which is now stereoselective. You see only the red linkage that has been formed between this donor and acceptor, which is only alpha. Once we got this pentasaccharide motif, we remove the TBDPS group using HA pyridine first to get hydroxy derivative, and then esterify all this the hydrolysis of all this ester, and then remove the benzyl group using hydrogen palladium charcoal, and then global sulfation of all hydroxy group using sulfur trioxide triethylamine, end up with this compound in good yield, 59%. Now next part, I'll show our approach to synthesis of the N-glycan. So last 15 or 20 minutes, I talk about the glycosamine glycan, which are done heparin, that is negatively charged. Now N-glycan, this is not a charged glycan. And as I saw before, there's two kinds of linkage. One is N linkage, you count L-glycan, or O linkage called O-glycan. Now, as the structural pattern, these are divided in three class, oligomannose, complex, and hybrid. And major cases, if you see the core unit is same, there's no differentiation between the complex, oligomannose, and hybrid. But the differentiation come, or the structural differentiation come when you talk about the branching unit. Now, why we need chemical and chemoenzymatic synthesis? Because naturally occurring glycan in isolated small quantities and difficulties or problem in separation and closely related isomeric structure. Let's consider this structure, which has mass of 1976.1. Now you never know this sialic acid, that is pink color sugar, will be in this left arm or right arm. So to understand those, we synthesize asymmetric type N-glycan to make a vaccine candidate. Now, coming to the carbohydrate vaccine, I just want to give a very, very detailed introduction. If you are really interested in this, you can go through this article published by Dr. Wang back in 2015. So the approach is first to identify a unique glycan epitope in the surface of the cell. And now next step is synthesize those glycan and conjugate the glycan with the carrier and adjuvant The role is adjuvant is to recognition of the receptor in the dendritic cell or B cell for the immune response. And then these generate IgM antibodies, that is short-term T-cell dependent immune response. So here I shown you how Dr. Wang and co-worker developed a GlovoH DT vaccine starting from GlovoH. This is a synthetic protocol. So initially they attach GlovoH with the linker, now attach with the protein, modify the protein linker later on. And then introduce the adjuvant here, C34, that is the sugar entity. Now, major challenge of carbohydrate vaccine was to switching IgM to IgG by long-term T-cell dependent response. And the other part is how to synthesize this kind of glycan. Once you, if you don't have access to this glycan, you cannot develop a vaccine candidate using carbohydrates. This is some of the example that kind of glycan present in breast and cancer, breast and lung cancer cell. You can find the presence of the aberrant sialic acid or fucosylation in the structure. As I mentioned before, this structure is very difficult to synthesize because if you change the glycosylation linkage and the position, consider this tetraantennary glycan left hand side, you can get 168 isomer. Now you consider any development of synthetic method, if you start in one particular methodology, you cannot end up with accessing all this glycan. So how to tackle this problem? So we start with the concept that we'll use chemoenzymatic approach, in which our protocol that we synthesize this trisaccharide unit. You can see here two GlucNAC and one mannose unit, as indicated in blue and green color. That is present majority in the all glycan. And once we can synthesize this trisaccharide, we can elongate the arm using enzyme. So now, first, how to synthesize this this trisaccharide? So we started compound one and two, which can be synthesized from mannose and GlucNAC, and then couple them using glycosylation condition to get compound three. And you have now benzylidine right here in three, so you can open either 4-hydroxy or 6-hydroxy to get compound 5 and 4. And we also change acetyl of 2 to make it benzyl 2A, and then again couple them to get compound 6, and then opening of the ring to get 6-hydroxy derivative compound 7. So initially we attempt the glycosylation between 2A and 4, but we did not end up with this trisaccharide. So we change acetolyl of 2A to phosphate using known procedure to get compound 8. And once we couple 4 and 8, we end up this trisaccharide 9. Now, once we got this trisaccharide, now there's a choice whether to remove this acetyl group or benzyl group, but we need to do chemoenzymatic synthesis. So we remove this benzyl group because we need to dissolve this compound in water. So we remove this all greasy part. We remove benzyl and thalamide. So we remove thalamide first using EDA and butanol, and then acetylation of this NH group to get NHSE, and followed by removal of this benzyl group to get trihydroxy derivative here. So in 11, compound 11, you can see the triacetyl NHSE, the beta 2 arm. So if you change the one of these glycosyl donor, you can also synthesize this beta 2, beta 6, another trisaccharide in which triacetyl moiety in beta 6 arm. Using similar fashion, if we couple compound 5, which is 4-hydroxy derivative with 8, we get this compound 12. And in the same protocol, we end up with 14. Now we have beta 2, beta 4 linkage. So next we attempt chemoenzymatic synthesis. So we took one of these trisaccharide, and then the enzyme was isolated and purified in-house. So you treated with beta 1 for galactose T using UDP gal in tris buffer to get beta 4 linkage of galactose here in this arm, right? And then we treated this tetrasaccharide with alpha-2,3 sialic acid in presence of the other enzyme to generate this pentasaccharide. Now take home message is that this is the first report to which we have shown that triacetyl moiety is tolerated by glycosyl transfer like beta-1 for gal-T or alpha-2,3 sialic acid. The last part I want to show how a synthesis of sialidase resistance oligosaccharide can be done using programmable one-pot methodology. Now, concept here is to improve the stability of sialylated glycoprotein. So if you have normal normal glycoprotein transmitted with the normal glycan, then the presence of sialidase can hydrolysis this linkage. You can see the sialic acid, the pink color sugar. So our aim was to improve the stability of the glycosidic bond by introducing a fluoro group at C3. So to study the prolonged half-life time of the antibody for therapeutic antibody. I'm not going to show details of this, but how one-pot synthesis program will help us. We make this hexasaccharide. Once we synthesize compound 14, 15, and 16, have the decreasing order of RRB. You see 14 has 2053 RRB, whereas 15 is 537, whereas 16 is 0. So we make this hexasaccharide 17 and form hexasaccharide 17 in 8 or 9 step. We end up with this desired glycan, which has 3-fluorosialic acid. Now, this part has been done with the collaboration with the glycobiologist in our group. So we took commercial monoclonal antibody and digest with endo-S and endo-S2, which is wild-type endo-S2, to remove all this sugar part in the Fc region to get this this intermediate, and then treated with the endo-S2, which is recombinant endo-S2, and with the glycan to get this modified monoclonal antibody in which we have 3-fluorosialic acid. And it indicates that this normal commercial MBA and this modified MBA both has same affinity and the function. However, the stability and the half-life time has been improved by introduction of the 3-fluorosialic acid here. This is my couple of publications out came from this work. And at the end, I thank Professor George Weissheit at Harvard. Here I'm doing completely different project, but using carbohydrates and some analytical chemistry in combination with Professor Chiwei Wang to give me the opportunity to work in this complex oligosaccharide, Professor Jayaraman and ISC to introduce me the field of carbohydrates. And Professor Faizal Reed, he's a retired professor in NPG, is an institute in North Carolina, USA, for his content motivation, and GIST University for this invitation, and Dr. Partho Ghosh for this invitation to give a talk here via Zoom. All my lab mates, fellow mates and friends in all the institutes, my parents and family, and thank you. Stay safe. If you have any question, I try to attend this. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Supyode. It is very good, wonderful session. Now open to all. Please unmute and.
So I need to remove the sharing, right? Yeah, I find some of the question. Can I answer this or?
Okay.
Hello?
Yes, okay. Please.
Yeah. Some of them asked about one question I found that how this autotrophs predict building blocks, what is the basis of the machine learning approach, can you also predict the yield efficiency? Yeah, so autotrophs predict the reactivity based on the donation, electron donating power or accept electron donating or electron withdrawing power of the protecting group. And it took the approach from the 1H NMR, sorry, 1H chemical shift. So for theoretical approach, we took this compound and draw in chem draw, and then find out what is the predicted 1H value. And then we incorporated those parameters in the software. And experimentally, we synthesize those molecule and we measure the reactivity and put all this RRB value inside the software. And yes, it can predict the yield or the efficiency of the reaction. Now the autotrophs software can predict the yield. However, majority case we found the yield is good enough compared to minus or plus 5%, but some of the case it may not be. Does this provide information about chemical parameters? No. So autotrophs software cannot provide the information of So this all combination of the steric effect, non-steric effect, everything has been incorporated, but this all based on only 1H parameter, means the PPM shift, chemical shift. So other physiochemical parameter, it cannot explain it, or it cannot explain also the effect of the solvent, because in some of the cases you switch the solvent, but the effect of the solvent will be same for all the building block or not. Majority cases it will be same, but it cannot predict those part. Anything? So how to go top?
No one side scroll is there. You can scroll on that. Sidebar. In the chat box, one sidebar is there. Or you can stop sharing also.
Yeah, that's better.
View of
top sharing and go to that.
Can you approach make some side product? Oh yeah, no. That prediction of the software for information about the physical. There is no circumstances we got like self coupling of this monomer or dimer. So we never found any dimer, because that is governed by the difference between the reactivity. So, but as we are not mixing together all, we are doing in sequence, and the reactivity is very different from first one to second one. We did not find majority of cases, we did not find any side products. But however, EPO reaction condition is not good enough, that if you have some water or this kind of, or you don't have dry your molecular sieves, then you can get side product. That is everywhere. If you do normal reaction, so you get the side product. Your hydrolysis of this donor or the migration of the hydrolysis of the protecting group, which is sensitive. What does auto predict? Okay. Does the
open person? To all? Anyone can question.
Anyone? I think I answered all the questions from chat.
Any question from any side? I think there is no question.
No, Partho sir, I think one more question is lying unanswered in the chat box. That is some Devnath Ghoshal has written, how does AutoCHO predict?
No, I just answered Devnath question. How does AutoCHO predict building blocks? Yeah, what is the basis?
What are the basis of machine learning approach? Can you also predict yield or efficiency of reaction?
Yeah. I already answer that question. Yes, we can predict the yield, and as I mentioned before, the majority cases yield match with the predicted one, but as you know, the laboratory setup sometimes it may not, so there's a plus minus 5% changes in the yield.
Hi Shapriyo.
Yeah.
Hi.
Yeah, hello.
Hi Shapriyo, can you hear me?
Yeah, yes, go ahead.
Can these softwares actually give you the Gibbs free energy change, where the reaction will be energetically favorable or not?
No. Don't consider that. Here, we don't incorporate that, yes, no. No, but the question is, it will be favorable based on the reactivity. So once you get the output, there is a definite change in the reactivity. So in majority of the cases that we have incorporated all this building block and with the measured RRB, we find the success of the reaction. And I don't think so we have incorporated any thermodynamic parameter in the software program. Yeah.
Thank you, Priyo. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Any question from any end? Any Any question you have? Okay. I think there is no question. Okay, finally, we come to the end of this wonderful and highly informative sessions. I would sincerely thank to Dr. Supriyode for giving us his time and efforts. Particularly, I would like to thank our audience for joining us and their engagement. And this session should also serve as a reminder to us about Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore, words that science should be used to advance the society and not the other way around. Today's science in the form of advanced technology has enabled the holding of this session, and we should spiritually advance ourselves to take full advantage of such scientific innovation. The fact that Dr. Supriyode took time to enlighten us, considering his busy schedule, increase our indebtedness to him manifold, and we always look forward to hosting him once again. I would like to end the session with a promise to meet once again with an even more interesting and better topic.
Yeah.
So, Dr. De,
thank you.
Now,
thank you. Thank you.
Okay. I'm going to meet you.